Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our outstanding producer, Mr. Aaron Zommers, on the board this afternoon. It is Wednesday, September 27th, Hump Day, here at beautiful Civic Media.
Hump Day!
There you go.
Holy cow, Aaron, man.
And our resident crossover host, our colleague, our friend from up north on the banks of Lake Wissota, host of Up North News every morning, 6 until 8, our one, the only, Pat Kreitlow. Pat, how are you?
Man, it was so fleeting. It's almost like you weren't really here in Chippewa Falls earlier this week. You're here and you're gone, and I'm back here all alone.
Well, we'll be back soon. We'll be back soon. Now that I know how to get there to the actual studio, that's fantastic.
I was going to say, did you enjoy the trip at least?
I did. I mean, those beautiful fall colors are popping up north there. They're just really starting to come into their own, so that was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And for those watching on the stream, by the way, behind Aaron Zommers is a door, and just out of the door was Nate Wiggyhouse, one of our news people and producers. People have asked, is that a bathroom? And I say, no, it's actually it's a studio.
Wouldn't that be funny, though?
Right?
It would be funny. Luckily, my nose is not the most functional in the world, so I probably wouldn't be too bothered.
But it would be funny if you could set it up, put a sensor on the door that whenever it opens or closes, a flushing sound comes over the radio so that people watching the video feed would know.
That'd be great.
Yeah,
I think I could do
that.
No,
it wouldn't. No, let's not.
True.
Let's not.
But yes, up north, it was beautiful. Great to be at the Pablo Center at the confluence there at the Chippewa and Eau Claire River, right?
That's right.
And a beautiful facility. Saw Garrison Keillor. That was a lot of fun. And got to hang out with Pat a little bit. And John Kelly, our news person up there at WCFW. Lots going on up in the North Woods.
James Kelly. Before I forget.
What did I say, Jim?
John.
John. Oh. It's been a long day.
It's no problem, Tom. Don't worry about it. I'm good. For every time I get called Matt or something like that. Yeah. Oh, or whatever you think you hear. Yes, exactly.
Pat Krybeck.
Yes. Let's not even go there. This has been a thing.
I know. That's why I brought it up.
For 25 years.
Tell people because there was another legislator.
Here's the story.
Yeah, it is. Let's hear it.
Before I came along at Channel 13 in Eau Claire, there was another dark-haired reporter turned anchor named Rob Krybeck.
Yes.
K-R-E-I. Both our last names start with K-R-E-I. Both have three-letter first names. And people have been calling me Rob mistakenly for 25 years, and I'm sure Rob hears Pat occasionally because we both served as anchors. We both, after our time in TV, got elected to the legislature. We never overlapped.
Right.
Yeah, he did both of those things ahead of me. But it's still not as bad as it used to be. But it used to be at least a couple of times a week somebody would go, "Hey, Rob."
Oh, jeez.
No. And we could have nipped it in the bud very early on. We do the at TV 13, they do an annual Christmas greeting. Everybody kind of says Merry Christmas.
Oh, sure.
So they do a little something funny. And one year, Rob and I actually taped something together where we hold up cue cards. And I'm like, "I'm Pat. I'm Todd." It was funny. It was going to fix it once and for all.
Yeah.
And the station manager at the time said, "Oh, we can't do that because, Rob was a Republican." And they're like, "Oh, some Democrat might demand equal time." And I'm like, nobody's going to do that.
But equal time for telling people what your name is?
Yes. Yes. Well, that is one of the problems that comes with small market TV management. How much time do you have? No, we'll get into all of those
at some other point. At least you and Rob Krybeck appeared together, so they knew you weren't the same person. The same cannot be said of Pat and Babe Buchanan. You never see them together.
Good point. Never thought about that before.
It's just Pat Buchanan in a wig.
Yes. Ooh.
Well, we've degenerated quite a bit here on the show. Anything popping up there in the North Woods you want to talk about in particular? Was on your mind?
What do you got? Me leaving it. I am so
now,
thankful.
Don't say that because people are going to be like, oh, my God, pack weight loss. It's just a vacation.
No. Temporarily going to take a couple days off. And this time around, instead of running best of shows, you have graciously agreed to fill in this coming Friday. Tomorrow will be my last show. You'll do this coming Friday. You'll do next week, Thursday and Friday. Chad Holmes is going to do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. At least we think so. And as I mentioned on the radio this morning, it's not that I don't think you can, you know, get up and you know, do a 6 a.m. show. Mm-hmm. It's just the inconvenience of you doing it that has me a little worried, but I'm sure you're up to the task. Wait a minute. You have a Civic Media t-shirt.
Yes.
You did not bring me a Civic Media t-shirt when you came up.
I just got it. I didn't have it when I came up there. I promise you we'll get you one. Yeah.
Wow.
Absolutely.
I'll
trade you this for an Up North News t-shirt.
You know what? I don't have a Civic Media t-shirt either.
Well, good.
And nor an Up North News one. So we're going to do like in soccer matches. We're just going to do the trading of the jerseys.
There you go.
We promise to turn the cameras off when we take these shirts off and exchange them with one another. But yeah, we'll have the full jersey exchange.
Yeah, that'll be great. Well, my first job was as a paper boy for the Wisconsin State Journal. I had to get up at like 5 a.m. So, you know, I just set the clock for those. It'll be fine.
Well, I think it might have been a couple of years since your first job.
Yeah.
That's a good way of saying Todd's old, but yes.
Yeah, but I'm
very
grateful.
I did radio for a long time.
Yes, you did. And, oh, by the way, did you know today is National Morning Host Day or something like that?
No, is it really?
On the calendar? Yeah.
So it's your day.
Along with all the other things. It's always National Something Day or another. And today is also National Morning Show Host Day. And I know you once had a morning show, but not anymore. So this day, not so much for you. So happy day for me.
For Pat Quaitlaw, our morning show host, 6 until 8, Up North News. Thank you, Pat. We appreciate it. Have a great time on vacation. See you in a couple weeks. Yeah.
Yep. Thank you.
Stay tuned. Trygve Olson, Lincoln Projects next. Don't go anywhere. This is the Todd Allbowl Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allbowl Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is Wednesday, September 27th, 1:15 in the afternoon across Wisconsin. And on the app, Mr. Zommer's on the board and rejoining us on a Wednesday, as per usual, after having Jeff Timmer here last week, which was wonderful. Jeff was a great guy, but great to have our regular friend and contributor, Mr. Trygve Olson, a native of Wisconsin, longtime Republican advisor on here in Wisconsin, and went on to work for people like Mitch McConnell and John McCain nationally, and did some international democracy work, like me, left the Republican Party for his own reasons, and now is a senior advisor with the Lincoln Project, and we find him back here in Wisconsin, actually, not too far from where I was yesterday in Eau Claire, beautiful Hudson. Trygve, thanks for making the time for us. Appreciate it, my friend.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, Todd. I'm glad Timmer entertained people. If you're not following Jeff Timmer on Twitter, you should be.
Yeah.
He is irreverent and really, really funny.
Well, I think people really enjoyed, like you, we get a lot of comments when you're on every week, and you can follow Trygve at Trygve, that's Trygve Olson with an O on Twitter as well. And like you, Trygve, Jeff he's very blunt and real about it and just lays it out there. And I think that's what cuts through in all of today's spin.
Yeah. And I had some family stuff that I was dealing with, Todd. So it was kind of a last minute cancellation, but you know, the thing about Timmer is, being in Michigan, he can provide some really valuable perspectives because, quite frankly, the demise of the Michigan Republican Party is ahead of the demise that is happening in Wisconsin. They're just a little further along in this process of crazy taking over. And I hope he had a chance to touch on that with you a little bit about how that's unfolding. And also the job Gretchen Whitmer is doing. And Jocelyn Benson and Perino, the AG, of really doing what Tommy Thompson did in Wisconsin in reverse, which is staying true to their principles, but getting suburban former Republicans to join with them on the Democratic side.
Yeah, I think it's a coalition of, as you mentioned, Tommy Thompson did it to a large degree here in Wisconsin. Gretchen Whitmer and the Democrats are doing it in Michigan, building this coalition around what's best for your state, kind of leaving the fringe politics out. But hey, what can it just advance the basic things that all Wisconsinites or all Michiganders like? And I think that's what the majority of folks like to hear.
Yeah, you know, and the truth of the matter is, you know, Republicans, and it isn't just Republicans who have a monopoly on wanting to see more efficient government and potentially paying lower taxes, but also having you know, services provided that are needed. And I'll tell you, I'll share this with the audience, and you know this. I've just been going through my mom's sort of end of life issues, and it has been incredibly enlightening to me some of the gaps. You know, people who are Generation X, our age, pretty much everybody's got aging parent issues. And there are some, you know, challenges that government could be doing more to help people.
Yeah.
And that doesn't necessarily mean just even expenses, but, you know, there's a lot of good intended, great people helping out as you're going through it. But they're not getting some of the support they need from government either. And that's something that isn't a partisan thing and shouldn't be, quite frankly.
Right. As long as you brought it up, I'll simply say we offer our good vibes and prayers to you and your family, Trygve. I know it's been a difficult week, and we appreciate you taking time for us. So certainly thinking of you and your family this time.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Absolutely. But you're right. You know, my parents are aging as well. Mom just had a knee replacement surgery. Dad's had a couple of health issues. And you're right. When you get into your 50s, depending upon how old your parents are, it's almost you start reversing, and instead of them taking care of you, you're assisting them. And I'm like you, I know I'm happy to do it, but you start realizing things that you don't even know or realize in your 30s and 40s because you're not dealing with it. And once you're forced to deal with it, it's like, oh my gosh, things are just messed up in a lot of these things. And I think more politicians on both the Democratic and Republican side who can focus on these real day-to-day issues that affect actual Wisconsinites, actual Americans, you're going to be more successful.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it's supposed to be about, right? Solving problems that people have. And, you know, you can have efficient government that doesn't have to be big government, that still provides safety net for people and can help people out. And quite frankly, you know, in the situation that we were in with my mom, I felt incredibly lucky because my sister, that's what she does. She has a degree from Madison in geriatric social work. And I have the flexibility to be able to take time off to be with my mom at the end. But a lot of people don't have that opportunity. And, you know, there has to be ways to help people accommodate. And I think that gets into really, at the end of the day, with the what we're seeing and what people have to ask themselves is, what are we as people? Mm-hmm. Are we angry and mad? And, you know, we joke about Tommy Thompson running around sucking on lemons all day long, mad at everybody. Or are we going to go for our better angels and try and find ways that we can, you know, help where we can?
Yep.
And you know, and I'll also tell you, you know, the whole, there is no red or blue America when you're going through this, right? Like the people on the left who bash on Trump people, I'll tell you what, we had Trump people bringing us hot dishes and food and running errands for us. And we had people on the blue side who were doing the same thing. No one was asking that. Mm-hmm. So,
I went and saw Garrison Keillor while I was up in Eau Claire over the weekend, and with my sister and brother-in-law. And Garrison Keillor, who don't know, he had a long time show on National Public Radio, Prairie Home Companion, and writes about, you know, Lutherans and church dinners and small town America like Wobegon and places like River Falls or Michelin Center, where Trygve and I are from respectively. And I think you're so right? It's in these small towns, we for the most part help our neighbors, and we don't often care about who you vote for in the voting booth most of the time, except those couple of months when the yard signs pop up and the politicians prey on each side and try to divide us. And there is more good in our rural communities in Wisconsin than there is bad. And to your point, when we really need each other, that's when we show up for each other.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, I think, you know, in the bigger picture, you know, and I've said this to you, I think, offline. I don't know if I've ever said it online. You know, Wisconsin is going to decide really where the nation goes in 2024. It is going to come down to really Wisconsin, Arizona, a few states. And I'll tell you, in Wisconsin, it's going to come down to places like Richland Center and River Falls and people making that decision about who are we as people. And it is the one thing that gives me hope because, you know, you couldn't ask for better people in terms of how much help. And I think they're going to take that role really serious. Yeah. I know that for a fact. And I'm glad that it's that way because having, you know, been around the country, it isn't that way everywhere.
Yeah.
So
very fortunate to live in Wisconsin, to be from Wisconsin, to have those great Wisconsin vibes where we take care of each other. One place.
And we got a great football team too.
And we got a great, let's just go there. Because too often we wait to the end and we don't have time. Trygve is a Packer owner, like many out there listening. I'll just give you the mic for a couple of minutes, Trygve. What an incredible comeback by Jordan Love. I was listening on the Civic Media Radio Network on RCO, Richland Center, and Wayne Larrabee at the end, he says, dare I say it, all you need is love. That's how he ended the game. What about that comeback victory?
It was incredible. And I will tell you, so my mom, who passed away last night, she had not spoken. She was on hospice for probably 36 hours. And the nurse comes in and all of a sudden she wakes up. It was about 11:30 on Sunday. And the nurse says to her, she wakes up and looks at her and she's like, oh, you're working. And the lady smiled at her and she said, oh, are you waking up for the Packer game? And my mom says, well, we got to find out if we love the love. And then my kids were here and my nieces and nephews. And next thing you know, mom is up wanting to watch the game. And that was really the final memory that my kids will have, was watching the Packers with her. And what a remarkable victory. So wow. I think
incredible.
The thing about Jordan Love, and then the Vikings lost, which was the crown jewel of the whole thing. But I will tell you, the thing about Jordan Love, this is the thing, is like, he's got Aaron Rodgers mechanics, but man, there's a little Brett Favre in him. Yeah. And I don't know. I'm excited about it. I mean, it's three games, but we maybe pulled it off.
Right. No, it's a really exciting to watch and huge game on Thursday, right? Tomorrow, I mean, the Lions who are looking good as well. I mean, this you know, it could come down to the end of the season. You might look back at this game to decide who's going to win the NFC North.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. And I mean, we'll see what happens. But it is neat because I think there's a transition to Rodgers leaving, but people are. And I think I'm this way, and you're probably this way too. There's something exciting about sort of the fresh start of a new quarterback and kind of a young team and all that goes along with that. So, we're lucky.
We're
really lucky.
Absolutely. Remember, you can listen to the Packers on the Civic Media Radio Network in a select market. One of those is WRCO in Richland Center, FM 100.9, where the Packers play out across southwest Wisconsin. And as a reminder, unfortunately, we are not able to stream the Packers on the Civic Media app due to the NFL rules, but you can listen to them live in places like Richland Center right here on the Civic Media Radio Network. And just for those listening, thinking what's Todd doing, Trygve and I did talk this morning, and it was his choice to come on today, and I really, really appreciate it in a difficult time. Again, our thoughts and prayers to you, Trygve, and your family.
Hey, this is therapeutic for me, Todd. I'll tell you what, there's nothing I like better. I say this to you all the time. Coming and talking to you and your listeners, best hour of my week professionally every week.
We deeply appreciate it. Appreciate your friendship, and we're doing this one for your mom today in honor of her. So we will continue on. We're going to turn the page when we come back here. Maybe I got about a minute and a half before the break. If you want to call in and talk to Trygve and I a little bit about politics on the other side of the break, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. When we come back, Trygve, I want to play you a little clip of someone that was around in our day, Newt Gingrich, who went on Fox last night to attack Republicans for being crazy. I mean, where are you at when Newt Gingrich calls you crazy?
You're off the rails, man. That's just like, that's the pot calling the kettle black.
Exactly, right? I mean, they are at a point where, I mean, you look up dysfunction on your hey Siri, show me dysfunction, and Kevin McCarthy and the Republicans in the House pop up. I mean, it's beyond bizarre.
It's like a Viking fan telling you what it's like to win a Super Bowl.
That's exactly what it's like. So, I think it's absolutely ridiculous what's happening out there. We're going to come back and talk a little bit about that. Also, President Jay Rothman of the UW System is taking a little tour around the state of Wisconsin. I'll come back and tell you why I think it's a dog and pony show and get Trygve's thoughts on higher ed on that as well. And by golly, have you ever been out to Simi Valley? Have you been to the Reagan Library?
Yeah, for the debates.
Yes,
yeah, I've been out there as a tourist. I've been out there for debates. Yeah, we can talk a little bit about what it's like behind the scenes.
Yeah, we'll talk Republican debate. The second debate coming up tonight, we'll talk to Trygve Olson, a Lincoln Project on this other side. Take your phone calls as well. 844-967-2789. Back after this. Don't go anywhere. The Todd Allbold Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allbold Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is Wednesday, September 27th, 2023. By the way, the birthday of my oldest godson, Alex Kohler, celebrating on this 27th day. So congrats to Alex. He's out there in beautiful Indianapolis, Indiana. There you go. Happy birthday, Alex. We have in with us, per usual, on a Wednesday, our friend and ongoing contributor. He is the senior advisor to the Lincoln Project, Trygve Olson. Always great to have Trygve with us. If you'd like to join us, I have a question for Trygve or like to make a comment, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Trygve, we are headed towards, like lemmings off of a cliff, Republicans in the House of Representatives are... they can't come to a decision to keep government going. Looks like they're going to, in one fashion or another, shut government down by the end of the week. Former House Speaker, Republican Paul Ryan, was in town last night for an event, giving a speech or long-extended interview, however you want to say it. He thinks that Republicans are going to shut it down at the end of the week. Before we get your comments, I want to go to this cut from Hannity on Fox News from a couple of nights ago. We rarely, if ever, use cuts from Hannity, but we did this because Newt Gingrich was a guy at one time that you and I'll speak for myself. I looked up to because when he first started CPAC, like, oh my gosh, this guy could organize people. It was great, right? It turned out a lot different than it started, but the point is that Newt Gingrich is someone who was the Republican Party at one time. And here he is on Hannity on Fox from night before last talking about Matt Gaetz and the current Republicans in the House of Representatives.
As you got to pass a rule to get it to the floor. Twice now, different Republicans have decided to stop the bill from going to the floor. Why? Because each one has their own particular need or their own particular fixation. Now, there are one or two, like Congressman Gaetz, who I think is frankly deranged, who you're never going to get. He hates Kevin. He's not ever going to vote for Speaker McCarthy. He openly says he wants to get rid of him, you know, which is, well, that's his prerogative.
Nobody wins.
Right. But look, I mean, all the people in the Freedom Caucus who are cheerfully screwing things up need to understand, the moderates get to vote too. I mean, you make this a big enough mess, they will, in fact, find it to their advantage. We have a number of members from districts that Joe Biden carried by a good margin. Those members can decide in the end that they don't want the government to close. They're not going to get punished back home. They're not going to get beaten in a primary because they're in districts where people are going to say, yeah, that's a smart thing to do. So that this is a double-edged game, and some of the members don't. You know, I sometimes think we have some members who can't, not only can't play chess or checkers, they can't play tic-tac-toe.
Trygve Olson, what say you?
Well, there's a few things that are pretty rich about that soundbite. That's a great soundbite. First thing that's rich about it is the reason that we have the Matt Gaetzes of the world in Congress today, a lot of that started with Newt Gingrich, right?
Right.
That is where the Republican Party really started to go off the rails. And to some degree, I think there was a lot of good intentions, and then it all kind of went awry. Second thing is, you know, Newt and Hannity, it's ironic that they're basically saying it's a stupid thing to do and that these moderates may go with Democrats to do the right thing. He doesn't come out and actually say that. And the right thing is, we're going to have the government of the United States shut down because 25 members, Republicans in the House, are deciding that that's what they want. And it's a little bit like Tommy Tuberville not wanting to promote military people. We're seeing this all over. A small minority, and this is what people are getting really fed up with, a small minority is dictating to all of us bad stuff happening.
Absolutely. And to the former speaker, Gingrich's point, we've talked about this a little bit too. A lot of these Republicans who won last time around to give Kevin McCarthy his very tenuous speakership are from districts where Joe Biden won. If the Freedom Caucus pushes a government shutdown, correct me if I'm wrong, Trygve, this is like, you know, exactly what Hakeem Jeffries and the Democrats want to take back control.
It is what they want to take back control, but in reality, maybe this is what finally forces the hand of a bunch of these Republicans who are in the House who are trying to have it both ways. I mean, I think Kinzinger was in town recently, I understand, and was saying that Mike Gallagher wanted to vote for impeachment and then chickened out because he wanted to stay in Congress, not do the right thing, more like I need to stay. And these guys know that this is wrong. Mike Gallagher style, like there's a bunch of them who know this is wrong. And what they should do if they want to kill this illness that's infesting the party is just say, when you're doing this, we're going to vote with reasonable people, not caring what party they're from, to get the government going, to keep it open, make sure that our military is being paid. You know, all of the things that go along with that. Because quite frankly, the people in Beijing, the people in Moscow, they're laughing at this dysfunction. Mm-hmm.
Well, and you and I are old enough to remember when Newt Gingrich was the speaker and got ticked off because Bill Clinton made him sit in the back of Air Force One and decided to shut the government down. Did not work out well for Newt and Republicans after that, and it propelled Bill Clinton on to a second term. So the party in power in Congress usually ends up the loser if you're the one that shuts down government.
Well, yeah, that's absolutely true. And I mean, Newt Gingrich is the guy who said he was going to talk about Monica Lewinsky every single day because of how horrible it was. Well, his own personal life, he was, you know, having an affair himself. So like, I just think at some point Americans, and I'm hopeful that this is the case, start saying, you know what, like, we're going to set aside the partisanship, and we're gonna vote for the people that we know that are committed to democracy. And the truth of the matter is, right now, because Republicans keep giving into this dysfunctional wing, they're not standing with democracy. It's the Democratic Party that's doing that. And I say that as somebody who's a conservative, and who, you know, would agree with Republicans more on policy, but they're not being responsible. They're not being serious at a time when we need serious.
We do need serious, and that brings me back to Wisconsin for a second. As UW System President Jay Rothman announced this week that the UW System is launching their opportunity tour, as they call it, but they spelled opportunity OPPORTUWNITY tour, the opportunity tour. Clever marketing by the boys on the 17th floor at Van Nuys there. But here's the deal. Here's the deal, Trygve. You got Jay Rothman.
Not that clever, Todd.
Well, you know, somebody thought of it.
It's not.
But,
yeah.
But if you're making $250,000 a year, you might be a little bit more clever. I mean, who knows? But here's the deal. UW Richland was shut down in Southwest Wisconsin by Jay Rothman, and we begged him. We, because I'm from there and I was part of the community, begged Jay Rothman to come out and visit Richland Center and the campus there before he shut it down. He refused to do so. Now he's already visited all the campuses, all the 4-year schools. So this is really not that big of a newsmaker here. But he went to La Crosse. He's going over to Oshkosh. Oshkosh is seeing record furloughs because of the millions of dollars of debt in the UW system right now. He doesn't seem to want to address that. there is a crisis in higher education. And by the way, where the hell are the Board of Regents? I mean, the Board of Regents have become ghosts. We don't hear about them anymore. And why aren't we having a more thoughtful discussion with people like Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce, with K-12 teachers and school boards, a larger, honest discussion about education in this state, a la what Tommy Thompson did when he was both governor and president of the system?
Well, you sound like a mutual friend of ours has been in your ear. She sounds just like her.
Well, we've talked, and it's true.
Right. Yes. Our mutual friend, Chris, who knows more about education in the state of Wisconsin than just about anybody, says this all the time. Here's the thing. The universities, whether they're 2 years or 4 years, in the communities that they're in and the surrounding communities, are the hub of what a substantial part of what makes this state great, because they're hubs of workforce development. You know, the nurses that are in our hospitals, or the ones that were coming and helping take care of my mom, they go to places like River Falls or La Crosse. The teachers in the schools, right? Mm-hmm. All these. They're just the hub of the communities, you know, the small business people. And, you know, he can go out on this tour. It certainly isn't going to be the Eras tour with Taylor Swift, I don't think. But I doubt he'll be selling out stadiums. But the reality is, I don't know what he's trying to achieve with it. What he should be doing, and maybe he's doing this, we'll know if the tour is real, if he's going to these communities, sitting down with all these people, Republicans, Democrats, and saying the universities are the cornerstone of part, a substantial part of what makes Wisconsin a great state, and we've got to pull in all other aspects to try and help those universities. And that's not a partisan thing. No. But I don't know that he's going to do that. And you're right. The Board of Regents, I guess they're meeting in River Falls next Thursday. But where are they?
Yeah. I mean, you never hear about these people in the news anymore. You used to hear about them. I mean, our my former work colleague, Drew Peterson, used to work with me at the Klug office. It was always out there as the president of the UW Regents, was talking to people, was in communities. You don't hear from them anymore. But beyond my griping and grousing, the thing that gets me is, I believe in the Wisconsin idea. I believe that the borders, yes, of our state are our borders of the university. And extension has done so much in terms of education, our agriculture community. And I, yes, don't feel like there are real conversations being had anymore. I don't know if Jay Rothman wants to run for a statewide office, or if he's just a political guy, or what his deal is. But you match that up with Howard Markline, State Senator Howard Markline, co-chair of the Joint Finance Committee, and Tony Kurtz this past week. They're circulating a bill to put in $6 million, $2 million for each community who loses a university. We know that Richland is one. We know that UW-Washington over in Washington County in the eastern part of the state is two. But Trygve, there has not been a third university announced for closure yet. So I hope the news media, I hope the public goes up to Jay Rothman and says, so who's next? Because obviously somebody is.
Yeah, I mean, that is a really good question. And I think this is starting to become something that's becoming an irritant for a lot of these, you know, moderate Republicans. Again, it's sort of like the whole we're going to impeach Protasevich, right? They had a rebellion amongst the reasonable faction in the Republican Party. I think the same thing is happening at a voter level amongst Chamber of Commerce type Republicans across the state. And it will be interesting to see, can Democrats capitalize on it? I think Tony Evers did to a degree, if you look at where he increased his margins. And I think this is some of it. But yeah, they really need to engage. And to your point, you know, the Board of Regents used to be filled with kind of giants within the state. Adolf Gunderson from Gunderson Clinic.
James Clouser.
Clouser, right? Like, and these were people who you might not have agreed with their politics, but you didn't question their commitment to the state because they were critical pieces of the state. And I don't know what – I don't see Rothman. Maybe that's what he's going to try and do, but it sure doesn't seem that that's what they're doing.
Here off the WMDX text line, you can text us by downloading the Civic Media app on either your Apple or Android device. Off the text line, and this is – I'm actually glad this person texted this in. Of course, they don't give their name, but the text line says, quote, we should consult with Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce regarding the university? That's insane. Just shows you are still a Republican after all, unquote. I'm glad that person texted in. Here's because this is exactly the problem, the challenge we face in our state today. To have that kind of thinking that we're never going to talk to the other side, that is where we get into problems. And look, I do not agree with a vast majority of things Wisconsin Manufacture and Commerce is doing. You know, Mansky is basically running it, our old Republican colleague over there. But the fact is they have a significant role in our major commerce throughout the state. If you're unwilling to even sit down at the table and say, look, Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce wants a good economy. They want to protect business. All right. We should be working with our educators, Trygve, in my opinion. We can disagree on 90 or 85%, but where is that 10% we can actually work together in our communities to find common ground? I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
No, nothing.
All right. Sorry. That was a bit of a rant. I'm glad that person called in. We're going to come back and talk about the Republican debate in Stevie Valley tonight. Don't go anywhere. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 10 minutes before the hour of 2 o'clock. National news and weather update before hour 2. Right now, Trygve Olson, senior advisor to the Lincoln Project, Wisconsin native, former Republican like myself. And as we continue talking, I want to pick up, Trygve, before we get into the debate tonight in Simi Valley, California. I want to finish up on this anonymous texter calling in and kind of taking me to task for having the audacity to say maybe we should actually include Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce and the business community in the discussion about higher education in this state. Again, I am not a supporter of most things that Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce do, but they represent a lot of legit. And yes, this person says, well, they're lobbyists. Well, everybody's a lobbyist in Madison. So, I mean, you know, okay, fine. But Trygve, you said something off the air. I want you to tell people what you said in regards to what business means to Wisconsin, particularly in biotech.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. If you want to think about the biotech industry today, where Wisconsin is a leader, a massive leader, national leader, that you got to go back to when Catherine Lyle was president of the university. Donna Shalala, who went and served in the Clinton administration, was a Democrat member of Congress. Maury Andrews, who was the head of the teachers union. Jim Haney was the head of manufacturers and commerce. Tommy Thompson, governor. Republicans and Democrats in the legislature working together to say, how do we take these assets and leverage them into things that provide good paying jobs for people in Wisconsin, across the state? And that's what it takes. It's not, well, they're from WEAC, they're wrong on everything. They're not wrong on everything. They're right on some things, and there's common ground to be found. You can't, what's killing this state, to a degree, is killing this nation. I have to have 100% my way. What that leads to when you say that, you're no better than Matt Gaetz and the 25 people who are going to shut down the U.S. government. Or Tommy Tuberville, who's not appointing judges, members of the military, because I have to have 100% my way and everybody else is good or evil. It's not good or evil. You have to decide. We have to decide, are we a nation of people who have faith in each other, or are we a bunch of people who are afraid of each other? And the same applies to the state of Wisconsin. And the state of Wisconsin is a place where people have, on both sides, had a lot of faith. They can have Maury Andrews, Tommy Thompson, Jim Haney, I'm sure they argued it out all day long. I know they did because I was in the middle of it. But afterwards, they could sit and drink a beer and say, where can we find common ground? Because we all care about the kids who are going to school, and we all care that they can have good jobs when they get out.
I am so glad that you brought up those names. Catherine Lyle, Maury Andrews, Donna Shalala, Tommy Thompson, Jim Haney, from education, from business, Republicans and Democrats, because I think in today's climate, people have short memories and they don't recall that 15, 20 years ago, people from both sides could come together and hammer these things out for the betterment of Wisconsin. And that's what we need. And again, I'll go back to say one of the unfortunate, long-lasting, perhaps the greatest legacy of Scott Walker was the divisiveness that he sowed in this state from day one and Act 10. And this state has never been the same because neighbors are no longer trusting neighbors because of Scott Walker.
Yeah, and think about, you know, we're talking about the university. Think about the hypocrisy. I raise this all the time. But, you know, Scott Walker, you know, a woke center of indoctrination. But his own kid, Matt, he's incredibly proud that he graduated from the University of Wisconsin. If he really thought it was a woke den of indoctrination, what's he doing sending his own kid there? And why does he keep sending me Christmas cards with himself in Badger gear? Right. Give me a break.
Exactly.
Give me a break. We're not on a podcast, so I can't add an adjective to add some emphasis.
I think you should send a Christmas card back this year with a picture of you with a Badger Boys State t-shirt on.
I would not fit in my Badger Boys State t-shirt, and unlike Scott Walker, I didn't save it. So
all right, we got about 3 minutes left here. Let's preview the Republican debate. Is there really much to preview tonight? It's going to be on the Foxy, as Mike Crute likes to say, and from beautiful Simi Valley, which, by the way, if you ever get a chance, regardless of your political affiliation, go see the Reagan Library. It's a spectacular place to visit.
It is an amazing place to visit, and I will say, when you stand where Reagan is buried and you look out towards the ocean, it is moving just as an American to have that opportunity. Yep. That debate tonight, you know, I jokingly say that all these debates without Trump there, they're like the American League Central, where my beloved Twins are now champions of it, but I'm not really sure that it's winning much. Once you get to the playoffs, I do think it's going to be interesting because there does seem to be, you know, Nikki Haley did herself a lot of good in that last debate. There does seem to be at least some emerging hunger for an alternative to Trump. And it's, you know, it's going to be really interesting to see, do any of them go with an optimistic message that resonates and stand firm on their principles? Well, simultaneously calling out that this isn't right.
I mean, is there anybody going to have any courage to stay on stage tonight? You know, in the last week, we've had the former president and a sitting member of Congress call for the death of a sitting chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. When in the heck did that ever become the message of the party of Reagan?
Yeah, I don't know. Chris Christie probably will try and say that. Whether I think Haley, Scott, some of the other ones, you know, DeSantis is never going to say it because he's running, you know, he's basically given his beer to Scott Walker. Scott Walker, take you hold my beer. But the reality is, I think they would do themselves well to start creating that contrast. And I think, you know, the foundational question is, will one of them be able to push Trump into debating? You know, yeah. Will they do well enough to take second in Iowa? I think DeSantis is completely fading out, which is showing that trying to be out Trump is a road to nowhere. The other thing I would just add, I thought of this while you were making that point. The other thing Democrats need to be doing is saying Bob Menendez needs to resign.
Yeah.
They would do themselves a lot of good. I know some of them have.
Tammy Baldwin just joined. Tammy Baldwin just came out yesterday and said he should resign. So I admire her for that.
Well, yeah, but you know, but the reality is Tammy Baldwin is part of the solution, not part of the problem. And I don't agree probably on policy with Tammy more than 20% of the time, but she's somebody who will work across the aisle to try and get things done and has.
For Wisconsin.
Right.
Yeah. So
yeah,
it was great to see her join John Fetterman and Cory Booker and others calling for Menendez's resignation. About a minute left here. What do you make of some of this messaging coming out on the polling, trying to say that, you know, Trump's ahead of Biden? I some of this polling, especially from Washington Post, I think it was ABC, they even admitted it was weird outlier polling. Republicans trying to make hay of it.
I think the race, you know, Donald Trump versus Joe Biden again has the potential to be a really close race. And at the end of the day, what I think about, you know, there's going to be all kinds of polls that show all kinds of numbers. At the end of the day, I think it doesn't really change the reality. And the reality is it all runs right through Wisconsin, right up I-94.
right up here in Wisconsin. Trygve Olson, thank you for making the effort today, my friend. Our thoughts with you and your family. Thank you so very much. Really appreciate you. We'll see you next Wednesday.
Thank you.
Our pleasure. Yep. Don't go anywhere. Hour number two of the show is next. Your phone calls, 844-967-2789. Back with more after this. This is the Todd Allbowles Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.